So, welcome to the second episode of Tango Music Analysis, a new series in which we're going to explore tango music song by song from a broad perspective, musically, culturally, all these things. So if you want a slightly longer introduction to the idea of this series, just take a look at the first like 6 minutes of the first episode. But I'm going to keep the introduction short this time to, make the amount of time we can spend on the music itself as long as possible. So, today I have chosen a song called Santa Milonguita, in the version of D'Arienzo from 1939. And I've specifically chosen this song because I want to talk a bit about nostalgia in tango. So, nostalgia, like you could say that tango music is like a combination of melancholy and nostalgia. But there's also specifically, like in the sense of lyrics, there's a lot of nostalgia going on, especially for like the Buenos Aires of the past. And for us, Buenos Aires, the Buenos Aires of the past is the tango music from the Golden Age, and that's what we usually think of. But actually, the lyricists back then were referring to older times when life was simpler, and you know, it's kind of like, yeah, that's a bit of a strange thing. Like we have nostalgia for their times, and they had nostalgia for something else. And that's a very big topic in tango lyrics. So there are all kinds of examples I could mention there, but actually, I want to talk about nostalgia more musically in this case. And you could say that those songs that are generally nostalgic about like these old corners and streets of Buenos Aires, or like these figures from the past, like these archetypical figures, like the a street fighter or thief or a prostitute, or you know, poor people, the immigrant, all these things. But even though this song is about a prostitute, or most likely about a prostitute, I don't want to specifically talk about tango lyrics, but I want to see how nostalgia is expressed in a song, like musically. And that's a slightly different, you know, approach, because it's easier to say like this is nostalgia in a lyric and why, but it's kind of more vague to describe it in music. But this music still wants to make us feel this sensation. So today's song, Santa Milonguita. So you know the word, you know the word milonga, and it can usually mean two things, like the milonga dance or the song, or a place where you dance. But milonga, milonguita was also, you know, a term to refer to dance girls of the, you know, of the cabarets in Buenos Aires. So a lot of dance places had, a lot of people don't know this, but a lot of people had these like taxi dancer kind of women. Who would also, you know, not always probably, but some of them would also be, you know, available for prostitution, yeah, this is a bit of a strange thought that I, you know, I only recently myself discovered, you know, how massive this phenomenon was, thanks to Theresa Faust. So I'll link a video below in which you can hear more about this topic. But in this case, in this song Santa Milonguita, you know, the lyricist Enrique Cadícamo, who wrote several topics about like these kind of women, and in this case, it's a woman who falls in love, and you know, wants to live a different life, but in the end, you know, this goes wrong, and she ends back into this old life of prostitution. Even though you could also say that this lyric is very ambiguous, Like you could also say that she was maybe only a, some kind of free woman who like just didn't want to commit to a marriage. And one day she did, but then failed, and then she turned back to this dancing life, So it can kind of mean both things, but if you look at the lyrics more closely, it's pretty probable that she was a prostitute in some way or another. And for modern readers, viewers, listeners, whatever, this is kind of difficult to accept. But the strange thing is that back then, some of these women who wanted to be, emancipated and free, they lived this lifestyle, and in a world in which feminism wasn't really a thing yet. So it's like something of the modern world, and to us it seems very traditional and strange, the situation, but back then it was actually kind of modern. So we can talk about this topic another time, because again, like the idea of I'll talk a bit more about what happens in the lyrics, but in this case, I want to highlight most of all this nostalgia in the music. Like, why does it sound nostalgic? And let me just show you a few pictures before I continue with invite you to listen to the music together. So this is the sheet music. So as you can see here, this is the life of the milonga, of the dance hall, of the and this is the most likely, of course, the woman in question, whose name we don't know. She's just called Santa Milonguita, so it's like holy dance girl. This was one of the most famous dance places. This is a place where Darienzo played a lot, so it's kind of interesting that we're talking about a Darienzo song here. So these photos maybe might help you imagine how it was like they were playing in places like this, almost every day, and there were like, even if we assume this was prostitution, we're talking about a very high class of prostitution. So, you could dance with I'm sure it's not never really like set anywhere very clearly, but I think there were also just normal people, so to say, there, women as well, and couples. But yeah, it was a pretty standard phenomenon in Buenos Aires in those days. Here's another picture. This is just another place where you could dance. It's a very nice, historical picture with these men standing here. This English name, and this actually seems like something which is called Montmartre, and that's one of these typical things in tango with Paris and in tango lyrics. So let's look at the rest later. I would like to say a bit about the style of this orchestra, even though it's pretty obvious to pretty much everyone what D'Arienzo stood for. But in 1939, his style was most of all, it was the year in which his style became the fastest of all the years he's ever played, or at least in the golden age, but I'm pretty sure in all over his career, together with the pianist Juan Polito, who replaced Biaggi, because Biaggi left to form his own orchestra. And then in the early 1940, I've written articles about this as well, so I might link one, but I'll explain that. I'll link it next time. He left, so this Polito left together with the whole orchestra and the singer Echagüe, who you can hear today as well. They all abandoned D'Arienzo, and he had to form a new orchestra. But It's a very interesting year in Tango of 1939 for these reasons. But actually, I'm going to talk more about the specifics of Darienzo in 1939 in my next video, in which I will take an instrumental from the same year. So I'm not going to tell you what instrumental yet, but I'm going to take an instrumental and look at it more stylistically in a way, like why is this typical for Darienzo and of that year, etc. That kind of thing. But I've chosen this song again because I want to, talk about this nostalgia thing. And let's just start with the analysis of the music, because the second I hear this song, I can pin down why it's nostalgic. So I can talk a lot more about the why, but let's just hear it ourselves. So, this song is quite unique, even for this, not even, but quite unique for this year, for this style, because this is by far the most nostalgic and well, a bit repetitive, but let's say it unique song in this whole repertoire of the year, even of the 1930s with D'Arienzo. So it's it's a special song in a way. And let's listen again to these first seconds. I could start explaining why this is nostalgic, but maybe think for yourself a bit, like, what does this story want to tell you? If you would hear this now, some of you might be returning to the milongas already in some form or another. But even if you don't, just think of the past and try to imagine what you hear. For example, when a DJ, would play a song as the first song on the tanda, it's possible. To me, from the first second, it just tells me a very, very specific story about something. But that's the point. It's nostalgia. And let's listen to it again, just to hear it. So, let's now try to explain it. So I didn't say a word of human language, but the song is very sentimental. Listen to this violin here. It starts like the usual like style piano. Upbeat style of D'Arienzo, so it's still quite a fast song. It might not be as explosive as some of the other songs in the same year, but it's still pretty rough. But this is the intro, so let's make sure it starts at zero. Yes. Now listen to this violin. Listen to that again. You know, it's this violin. But it's not just the violin. You know, I can hear these piano sounds and all these things that try to make a story. And you could ask, like, what makes music nostalgic? Well, it's because you use certain notes. You know, you write, you know, the composer of this wrote a certain song, and even without lyrics, it's you know, it gives you a certain feeling, when especially when it's played so well by an orchestra like this, a very high quality orchestra, but tango orchestra, tango band, whatever. But you know, it's not just the design of the music. I feel like, you know, it's something I learned, you know, because I'm learning piano as an adult, that you know, you can play piano literally, like, this is what most beginners do, like you just play the notes from the piece, but then at some point the teacher is gonna say, yeah, you know, you're playing the notes well, but why don't you try to make music of this? And it's hard to explain if you haven't gone through this experience, but it's the same, like, you know, when you would sing, when you don't put any feeling into this song. So if you're gonna play some piano, you know, in the end, the most important thing is to add some feeling or some kind into this, you know, into your playing. Then it becomes music, or it's just notes. So in this case, it's like notes is musical design, but it's also the orchestra playing in a certain way. And you actually have two other famous versions of this song from totally different years. Not Golden Age, it's just, it's quite different. And you can, you know, it's still the same song, but it's played so differently, and you can compare it if you want. I'm not going to do that today. It's quite interesting, you know, all these choices you can, musicians were making in you know, in the stuff. So in this case, like, like all these things, not just the violin, I mean, the violin is quite obvious, but even how this piano is played, like, it's not just piano, but how the beat is made. This is the violin. And this, like, these beats, because Tarienzo was the king of the beat after all, but these beats. You know, they all point in the same direction, and, you know, now you're going to hear some more violin, which is very, very obviously, like I can just feel how this violin just tells me a story of the, something from the past, or something, you know, like, some kind of faded glory thing that is very, you know, suitable, you know, it's well connected to the lyric and to the kind of story, but so you hear a violin here, but it's kind of a solo of a violin, but the rest of the song is also very, the rest of the orchestra is also very present right now. It's this is so amazing musically. I love this song so much, you know. It's, you know, it's just this violin that's you know, it's starting like a new story, and then it's joined by this violin. Is more clear now. New phrase. So what I explained last time is that tango has these, answers, questions and answers that are like phrases that build up a musical story. And you as a dancer, and we're gonna actually look at this next with a dance video. So I haven't told this yet, but I'm talking more about the nostalgia now, and then afterwards I'm going to show you a video and tell you, how a professional dancer level couple, anyone with musical conscience could do this to varying degrees. But you don't have to be a very technically apt dancer for this, but you need to be able to feel. And we're gonna look at that afterwards. So let me check how long I've been recording. That's very long again. But yeah, let's just keep listening to this. So this is like a game of the bandoneon and the piano. So the violin stops. That's the bandoneon. It's just like this short question and answer thing, or statement and second statement, back and forth thing. So you hear bandoneon and then a piano. So let me listen to that again. Dun-dun-dun-dun. So that's two different instruments, and it's just not me talking theory or something. Like, this is what happens in the music, and it happens for you as a dancer. So you're listening, you might enjoy it and all, but this is dance music, so this happens so you can react to this music. This music is telling you the story you can dance to. And this is the same with nostalgia. It just sounds like this bandoneon is creating this story again. It's talking about something in the past. It sounds nostalgic, and then it's like the piano is just giving his opinion, his answer about the story. So, okay. Dum dum. Dum dum. So that's a bit of a different answer, because these were very staccato, and now this bandoneon story becomes longer. You have like dun 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 dun, and now there's a different story again. So these phrases, the instruments come back together, because it's not constantly solos of instruments, but you have a violin coming back here, and the violin might be telling another facet of this story of Santa Milonguita. It's all very nostalgic. Now, if I am not mistaken, this is where the singing starts. Let's just double check, because this is a video and I'm recording, so let's not make a mistake. Yes. So let's look at a picture here. I've, you know, well, this is just a joking picture I have from my own blog. This is Mr. Darien, so well, dancing, but it might just be what's it called? Fake in a sense, just for the photo. But this is a famous actress. Who's not very relevant for us, but it's D'Arienzo and he's dancing. Isn't that great? But now, more relevantly, this here is D'Arienzo and his singer Echagüe, which we are going to hear. And here's a picture by Michael Krugman, who shows him as well. This is Echagüe and this is D'Arienzo, the other musicians here. I hope this gives you a bit of an immersion thing. These are the people who are making this music. And actually, I've got two video stills here. This is D'Arienzo in front of his bandoneons and a violin. And here You have Echagüe singing. Contrabass or double bass or whatever it's called in English. And, you know, that were the pictures. Just to give you a little idea of who these people were, and you know, it's always nice to know. And here's the sheet music again. But you know, knowing this, let's go on and try to, you know, I've already talked about the lyric a bit, about the theme, and you know, I just wanna, you know, try to listen to how Echagüe talks about, you know, not talks about, but like how he also is like another instrument in his music, talking about you know, showcasing the nostalgia. So let's just listen to how he starts singing.
Santa Milonguita tenía los ojos tan grandes y claros que hacían suspirar.
So just this beginning is already, it's very obvious what kind of thing we're talking about. Why is this so nostalgic? You know, just listen to how he starts singing. So there's a lot of feeling in his voice, and to me it's very nostalgic. Like it could start like Santa Milongi, like no, it's not cheerful. It's kind of like, it's not very sad either, but it's in the nostalgia zone. So he sings like Santa Milongita. So he takes like a lower range of his voice. I don't know how to say that in technical terms, but you know, let's listen to that again.
Santa Milonguita tenía los ojos tan grandes y claros que.
Santa Milonguita tenía los ojos tan grandes y claros que hacían suspirar. So actually the translation of this is somewhat like, you know, Santa Milonguita, the dance girl, she had such like big and clear eyes, that you know, anyone who saw her would like grasp for breath or something, or just sigh because of the, you know, the sheer beauty of this woman. And then there's in the description of what she was like, you know, he keeps telling us some more details.
Era su mirada color verde mar, ella que fue siempre festín y alegría, y en el juego de copas cierto de champán, tú.
So, you know, it's about her, yeah, how would I translate that? But like I said last time, translating is very difficult, but like it's the something with like the vice of her lips, so it's kind of in the direction of prostitution, or you know, not being this kind of Christian lady, married lady, and you know, her eyes were at this very special sea green color, which is very common in Tango lyrics, verde mar. And then it says like she always was like she loved to party pretty much. That's not very poetic translation, but and she was cheerful and all these things. But one day she just got tired. She got sick of all this champagne and you know, like he sings now. Okay, that's annoying.
Ser buena, buena, cierto de champán, tuvo un bello arranque de sensiblería y quiso ser buena, buena como el pan.
So, you know, I could translate the rest of the lyrics, but let's focus on the nostalgia. So he has presented this woman, and now something happens. Well, what happens is that You know, she falls in love with someone and she wants to change her lifestyle. And then in the end, you know, misery knocked at her door and, you know, she returned to the old lifestyle. But let's listen to how this is being presented. What I like a lot is you have, like, when he's singing now, he has the same violin all the time as you had in the earlier part where there was no singing. So they like singing together, and I've always loved this about tango is that you always have like these, when you have a singer, it's not just a singer, but he's, you know, accompanying or accompanied by you know the rest of the orchestra. In a very embedded way. So you see that later in tango music when you know the singer started to get a too central place, then the danceability kind of disappeared because it's not really made for dancing anymore. And this is just the perfect balance between everything. The golden age. So here you also have the violin, and it's joined by piano. That's constantly the same piano. Violin. So his voice has been like this for all the time. Like it's a bit of a subdued voice almost. Like he's singing like this, like per un día cuando el amor más los ataba, golpeó la puerta crudamente, la miseria rudamente del amor los separó. So it's like a style singing that's like it's amazing how great these singers were back then in you know expressing all these feelings and these situations, and it's the same as the music does with its instruments. So again, this singer is like another instrument to the orchestra in the best dance music. And now the rest of the song. Piano solo. You can dance, this is great, you can dance to all of this, you know, I'm not talking very specifically about how to dance to it, but maybe we can see in the dance video afterwards a bit more, but like, this is all material for you to use in the milonga. Violin. Very nostalgic, like Thomas Hertz. Violin again. Bam! And now it's the last part of the song. Let's see what it does. A lot of violin. Very nostalgic. Let's listen to that again. How it comes together, it's so beautiful. While the beat continues, of course, because it's D'Arienzo. But it's not the beat that's important. The story is the most important. You can use both as a dancer. So don't just use one, because a lot of people just use the back ground beat. This bandoneon. So it's a bit of a more cheerful end to this nostalgic theme. You know, it's not really that sad. Like it's the song is not really that sad. And it became a bit almost like cheerful, like the opposite extreme at the end. So there's like a big package of nostalgia here. Okay, and now let's just immediately move to this. You know, I've picked this. No, wait, don't dance yet. I've picked this this couple because I personally prefer the like the milonguero kind of style the most, but I won't exclusively use that. It's just that I like this this performance in a sense of how to listen to the music and take the nostalgia from it and use it on dance floor. So last time I was criticized, well, actually it was very positive feedback, but I only showed a very little part of the dancing in my last video. So I'll show a bit more today, and actually it was not really my intention to do all these things at the same time. And today I've only done a bit of the song, so mostly the nostalgia thing. But I also have highlighted other things. But let's use this, to try to see how this nostalgia has been turned into dance, which is pretty much what anyone should be able to do with this music. And if you can't do it yet, you can learn. So let's just watch. Look, this is quite upbeat. We're using a rhythm. And I think something's gonna change already now. No, it's still upbeat, but it's getting a bit slower, look. So it's still D'Arienzo, so it's rapid, rapid, rap, but it's also becomes very lyrical because you have these both two sides in the music. Look what happens now. Well, nothing really different happened, but in the still case, they're still mostly choosing the rhythm. Let's see what I do with the next phrase. Look. So this is singing. And even though this is what's so fun about music like D'Arienzo, like they know that the most important thing in the music that's happening is the singing, which is like the violin. So it's all in tune, like it's very lyrical, it's slow. But the still time they're using like these games that are happening in the background of rhythms. So you could say that they use the nostalgia of this of the story of the lyrical side of the music, but it's actually the fun thing is that what you usually do with this type of music is that you combine the two things, so you're not constantly like as if like gotta catch a train or something, like I'm really in a hurry. No, it's both elements. So if we look at it again, look, he's just walking. Here they're still really fast, relatively. Now he's just walking. Very slow. I shouldn't say he, I should say they. Look. Look at that again. Walking, slow, calm. Rhythm game. Rhythm game. It's on the music. They're not inventing this. The music is giving him these instructions, and of course, these are really good dancers. But anyone can follow the music. And it's a shame that a lot of people, don't. Sorry to say so. It's still kind of calm, even though they're moving a lot, which is a choice, You can fill this in whatever way you want with whatever figures you would like. You don't even need figures, but they're, they're still in line with the song. And here's another nostalgic phrase with the violin, piano, both. So you hear that. Okay, here it stops. It's like, and then also the piano. And then you can choose to do several things. You can follow the singer, you can follow the violin, you can follow the piano. I follow the piano, but not only. Look, this is the piano. Here's still following the violin. This is the piano. Especially here. They're kind of following the piano, but you don't have to follow the piano. You can also just follow the singer, you can follow the violin, or you can even only follow the piano, and then you only move at this point when you hear the game in the background. So you become silent for a while, and then you use the game in the background. Okay. Violin and piano. They're mostly using the piano. Sad story again. This is funny, like, they were very rhythmical. And then he notices, or, well, he just probably predicts it, because at some point you're able to predict these things. He knows that there's a change in the music, because it was very rhythmical, and now it becomes lyrical again. Okay, slows down. Even though it's D'Arienzo, people think D'Arienzo is only like this catching the train stuff, but you know, it's so great in this music, even when you have other orchestras from like the early 1940s or something like that. When it's kind of rhythmical in a sense, but it can also be very lyrical. But you constantly have this change between the two things. It's obviously very rhythmical again. And this is just one style. You know, this is mostly their style, but even, you know, they have many different ways to dance to this music. And, you know, if you would take a salon couple. You know, I actually checked out a typical salon style video for this as well. And you know, they also use the music in their own way. You know, it might look a bit different, but the logic is still the same in the end. So the way you look and how you move, you know, these things can all, they're all individual factors. Like, nobody really looks the same when dancing. The music is still the same. So, and every song you dance to, every type of music, all these, every individual song is different. So you have all these hundreds of stories and all these people who dance to it in a different way. It's so rich. And, you know, I just wanted to conclude it here. Next time we will look at, a D'Arienzo instrumental from the same year, and I will probably expand on some of the musical concepts that I mentioned here. But this is it, and I hope you enjoyed, and see you next time.